So thank you again for giving me this time today. I want to start with something that is very, very a basic question. How do you think AI will transform education, the education profession, and higher education?
Okay. First of all, what I think is the following. Point number one, AI will change everything for everyone. It's two things different. Everything, basically all the industries will be impacted by AI, and education is one of them. And number two, everyone will be impacted. It means that you can do something very manual, you can do something very intellectual. Everybody will be impacted by AI. And when you think about why I can do this statement, in my perspective, it's the fact that the real promise of AI is about one thing, is about the fact that we are now facing systems which are learning. We are facing now systems which are learning. And if you think about what I said, it's just a complete shift between an era where everything was programmed, everything was rules-based, and we are moving to a world where now you, me, Charlotte on the phone will have to spend time with the system in order to teach the system to do something. And between you and me, it will not only you, it will not only be me or Charlotte, it will be a group of persons who will take time again to give to a system what is, in their perspective, the best practice. And when you think about learning, you need to think about pedagogy. And now I'm moving to your point, your business, education. Because if you really understand what I am trying to tell you, is the fact that learning means how to teach a system to do something. Point number three, the how is about pedagogy. What are you teaching? Three things: knowledge, what you have in your brain, know-how, what you do with your, what you know, and on a certain extent, behavior, soft skills, emotion, personality, and so on. So, to go back to your first point, education should be the first field of application of AI because it's all about pedagogy. You are somebody who needs to show pedagogy skills to teach to your students something, correct?
Yeah.
With AI, it is exactly the same equation. We need to find a way, we need to find the right pedagogy, we need to find the right method, process, in order to make sure the system it is learning from you the best you can bring to the system. And having said that, and after I will pause, pedagogy, learning, you think immediately to something which is basically the biases.
Yeah.
You need to think about ethics. You need to think about transparency. You need to think about robustness. You need to think about explicability, because as soon as you are starting to teach a system to do something, you are bringing, as a human person, all your biases, and we are all of us biased, you, me, and everybody.
Of course.
And we need to, sorry?
Yeah, of course.
And we need to make sure that this pedagogy, this thought process, this learning process, is done properly in order to mitigate as far as we can the biases we are bringing by design in this system. Make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. So you're talking about how we can train, like we can, through education, we can make sure that whatever we're having a role actually in teaching and helping machines to learn through the processes and the whole critical thinking that we're having and all the ethical approaches. But how about really the application of AI in education to help us in our field, right? To educate and to work with our students and higher education.
Very simple. If I was provocative, eh bien, Nadia, if I could be provocative with you, you are on a certain extent already in competition with AI. You personally, by the way.
Okay, why?
Because all your students are using AI-based system, even they don't know, or maybe some of them know, but at the end of the day, they are using on a daily basis AI system to do their education and to do the exercise you are giving to them. Point number one. Make sense? Because we are all day, they are on internet searching information, searching credentials, searching citation about somebody who say X in order to support a theory and blah, 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 blah. So you are already in competition with AI. That's why I'm going back to your first point before you record this session. You told me, Jean-Philippe, it is the right time, but it's more than time. The transformation is already ongoing. So you should now onboard right now AI system or AI use cases in your field, which is education, in order to make sure that you are on board. You know, I always compare, do a metaphor between AI and the surf. And I say, you know what, when you have a wave, you cannot stop the wave. You can only surf it. Mm-hmm. So you should now surf it. Let's continue. Besides the fact that you are already in competition with AI because your students are using AI today on a daily basis, you, in terms of professor and teacher, you should and you have to use AI in order to make sure that you can articulate your session much better than you do today, even if you are doing very well today, I'm sure. But for example, with AI, you can customize specific session education for a specific profile of student because AI is able to better understand the content and potentially better help you to better understand the student that you are facing in order to do the match between the right, let's say, pedagogy or the right lessons for the right profile in order to do the bridge and to make sure the education process is well done for a specific group of persons or for a specific student, for example. Mm-hmm. Make sense?
Yeah.
After, so, for your own course, if you do, for example, some research about a specific topic, you will use some AI system in order to bring you all the evidence, all the facts, all the information you need in order to help you to do your homework before you prepare your education course for your students. Again, another use case, for example. Let me give you another example. You can also use AI in order to do some specific training session for a specific group of students. Basically, you are using the information that you have on the students and you allow them to give you some information about what they like, what they want to do. And based on all this knowledge, you can identify specifically the right, let's say, cursus of lessons they have to follow to be perfectly aligned with their career goal, their willingness to learn, their appetite to learn, and all the content you have, you can do the match much more efficiently than anybody else in this call. Because you have to address not two students, but maybe 200, 300, 500 students, and to make sure they have, as far as you can, a customized pedagogical cursus aligned again with their needs, their ambitions, their dreams, and their capabilities. Make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. So in your talks, you talk about how AI is a human thing. It's less of a technological thing, that it's really surrounding human, and that you have human at the center, and you have all this collaboration between human and the machine. Absolutely. But when I'm coming from the background of education technology, we look at this field, we read a lot about, yes, this could be done. But how can we move from passive users to actually having a say in this transformation? Having really, you talk about a lot of things that have been, you know, repeated, but you need action. So from our field, how educationists, you know, how educational experts can actually have a role in this transformation?
I wrote a book in French, unfortunately, which is called, it has been published 9 or 10 months ago, Edition Duno. And the title of the book is L'IA sera ce que tu en feras.
Ah, bien sûr, oui, absolument. Voilà. Oui,
eh bien, in this book, L'IA sera ce que tu en feras, there is one, let's say, overall idea, which is, again, don't expect or don't wait anybody else to do something in AI in education. It should be you. It has to be you. Why? Because if you think about the first sentence I told you, what is AI? AI is about learning. Learning from who?
Mm-hmm.
From you. You personally. Because I'm not a teacher. Charlotte, the two Charlottes are not teachers. So at the end of the day, you as a teacher, you as part of a teacher group in your university, have to take the lead in order to make it happen. And too many people are asking the same questions, but why is not progressing so far? Why is not progressing now? Who should take the lead? It's you. You need to take the lead, the drive of AI, specifically in education, because you are the ones who has the skill set, who has the know-how, who has the patience, the conviction. So you need, it's really important because, and what I say is absolutely the same for healthcare, with doctor, with in legal, with lawyers, in my job of consulting with consultant, in the banks with bankers. Each of these industry have to take the lead because we are again teaching a machine to do something. Who can be the one, or who is the best to teach a system to do something, is the one who is doing the job. You are doing the job. He.
Okay.
Makes sense.
Absolutely.
And now I'm sometimes a little bit passionate about the topic, but this is good, I think, to be passionate about something. And I say, don't try to find excuse to not do it. Because point number one, I don't know how to do it. Answer wrong. You are the one who knows how to do, what is pedagogy. And if you don't know, change jobs immediately. It's not the case. You know perfectly. Point number two, you could tell me, Jean-Philippe, technology is not ready. Wrong. Technology is ready.
You need to find.
Excuse number three. It is expensive. Wrong. Open source is free.
But you need the skill set of people who will be with you, whom you will collaborate, right?
Yes, and that's why, on this point about the collaboration, if I may. Please, don't think only about data scientists. And this is a French guy who is telling you that. We are obsessed by data in France. Obsession. We are pervert of the data. So, yes, we need data scientists. But please, think horizontally. Open, be diverse. Bring people with a large scope of skills. Linguist, psychologist, sociologist, data scientist, yes, all together in order to make it happen. Because what I can tell you now is 10 years that I am doing AI on a daily basis. My main takeaway is the performance of an AI system is correlated with the diversity of a team who is working on it. And diversity is not just a question of gender. It is men, women, a usual thing. It is also race. Yes. Answer is yes. It's about skills. Yes. And bring together pluridisciplinary role. This is my main takeaway. Don't think, please, only with data scientists. Voilà.
Okay. So now I'm moving to another topic that we're still within that. I've been working with, especially in this COVID era, right? I've been working with teaching and learning centers in different universities worldwide, and they're faced with a huge challenge because they have to support faculty members in their transition to online courses, right? So they are limited. They have limited number of people within their teams, even though they are hiring more people. But because of the COVID now, before they had only to support some faculty members and transfer some courses, now they have to do it for everyone and have the support to everyone. So I was thinking, and I was listening to your talks and looking at Watson and what it could be done with Watson. And I was following, you know, the step-by-step that was described. And I was thinking, these teaching and learning centers, so who exist in every single university, in every single educational institution, how can they use actually AI to take away this barrier that they have? Because they have to scale up their support to faculty members worldwide, right? So I was thinking about, okay, so when you talk about Watson, right. And we can have, and I'm just giving you like the list that based on my understanding of what this platform can do. And I would like your comment on that and your reflection on that. So it can personalize faculty experience. It can streamline processes. It can predict barriers to designing, developing, and facilitating online courses. It can present recommendations to overcome the barriers. It can fix identified issues. It can provide recommendation to faculty. It can deploy virtual agents trained on faculty inquiries. So instead of having, you know, human beings replying to these very simple questions hundreds of times, we can have these agents. So it can really help teaching and learning centers to provide expert services to a large number of faculties faster. It can transform the workflow. It can make the team work smarter. So I've been looking at all of that. So if you had something to say to these teaching and learning centers, who really their role now is very challenging. They are at the center of the whole online transformation of courses. What would be your message to them?
If you want a message, it's very simple. To scale AI with your learning center, you need three things. Point number one, you need to design, build, and deploy the appropriate operating model. To scale AI is not happening by magic. It's not true. This is Harry Potter. If you want to be back to the reality, you need to build what we call a cognitive factory, or it could be called a teaching factory or a learning factory, but you need to build this operating model in order to support the deployment at scale of your program. And if you, point number one, after I will tell you more about this one in 5 minutes. Point number two, in order to scale and deploy at scale AI in education, you need to get the right data foundation model. In your specific field, you are facing a combination of unstructured and structured data. You have a lot of unstructured data, reports, documentation, documents, and so on, books, of course. And you need to be able to ingest all this information combined with data, structured data, numbers, in order to combine the beauty of these two worlds. The good thing now is with AI and data, and not only with AI, don't forget it's the AI and data, not only AI, you have the capability today to bring together the two worlds, unstructured and structured, to extract some insight. And that's why, be careful on one thing, many people are putting behind the word AI everything. I don't believe this is correct, because if you want, for example, to do some recommendation, you need to combine AI, cognitive capabilities, you need to combine predictive capabilities, analytics, and you need to combine prescriptive capabilities with what we call next best action. And all these capabilities are different and are supported by different tools and solutions. I will not deep dive in this field because it's not the purpose of our call, but please be careful with people who are putting behind the word, the umbrella AI, everything. It's not correct. Mm-hmm. And the third thing you need to be careful about is about, you need to be, your learning center need to be trusted, transparent, robust, explicable. 4 words, behind each of these words, you have a specific action plan to make sure to make it happen, to make sure that you are trusted, explicable, and so on. So again, 3 things: operating model, teaching learning factory. Point number 2: get the data foundation right, structured and unstructured. And pillar number 3: trust, transparency, explicability, and robustness. 1 word on the teaching factory or the learning factory. If you build, I hope it will be the case for you or in Canada, if you build a learning factory, in the learning factory, you have different streams. One of them is about innovation, the other one is about industrialization, and another one is about asset, and another one is about continuous improvement, and another one is about HR, skills, change management, adoption, appropriation, and so on. So you will have to think about this model to be efficient, because the challenge that we have today is not to deliver the use cases, because we know how to deliver them. It's about how to do it efficiently.
Yeah.
Which is a complete another discussion. Because you can deploy use cases without efficiency. This is not what our customer wants today. Our customers globally want to deploy efficiently their use cases. So if you think about what efficiency means, it means these three things. Make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Because again, like in my field, I'm in education, but more specifically in education technology, and my students, I prepare them to become, you know, education technologists who actually train for this future, and they work in these teaching and learning centers. So to make their work more efficient, I've been exploring, you know, this idea about how they can interact and work with what you've been saying, you know, to have this collaboration.
But you know what? If I were you, I will build a factory in your university. Build a factory. Try, even if it's small, build a factory. Build this operating model. Design it, build it, and fulfill it with your students. Because it is, again, in doing that people will understand what this model is bringing, how to improve it, and again, you will see in front of you, in the reality, the benefits you can get from it. And your students, because they will be involved in this initiative, will be part of it. It's much better rather than to talk about efficiency.
Yeah, the other thing is that what we're trying to do also with these centers, because the problem is worldwide, right, is trying to share these expertise and share these solutions. And I think that if we can apply, I think you have a comment here.
I have one comment because again, it's an open discussion. Because if you start to think globally and so on, if you think globally and if you think ecosystem, I would select for each of the satellite part of the ecosystem, a specific domain where you want to be to excel, to be top. Mm-hmm. And doing so, you organize a set of best of breed learning factory with specialization of a specific domain. It could be an industry domain, it could be a technological domain, it could be many things. But at least you are creating the right, let's say, ecosystem, which will bring to each other the best thing in this field. The worst thing is to do everything and to do it badly. Because the landscape of AI is so big. You have, as you know, you have language, you have voice, you have visual recognition, you have empathy, you have reasoning, you have blah, blah, many things. So to be the best in everything, that don't sound very rational. Make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. So last word to start. How can we start? Where do you think we should start? Again, going back to educational field, and when I talk about teaching and learning centers, these are guys who are training faculties. So we're the whole world of education and training, and we want to start. So again, people with no expertise, again, I talk about data science, but I agree with you that we have to be everyone. How can we start?
I will not tell you how to start on a use case standpoint, because I don't know. I'm always honest with myself. When I don't know, I say, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I will answer to your question saying, start doing two things in parallel. Don't do it sequentially. Select a use case, or at least two or three use cases. Never do POC. Stop to use this horrible word, POC. Talk about pilot. Mm-hmm. And you select two or three pilots, clear scope, clear expected value, clear lapse of time, and in parallel, you create a small factory which will be used to deploy the use case you selected. People are doing now POC, forget it, it's a nightmare, it's a waste of money, energy, and so on, it never works. And if you do the pilot and you create the factory in parallel and not sequentially, you will have at the end of the pilot something which will bring value, which will be scaled upfront. How? Based on the factory. So you basically, you are killing two birds with one stone. You make sense what I say? Voilà. That's it, madame.
Super.
Merci à toi, à bientôt, j'espère.
Merci beaucoup, absolument.